I hope no one is here thinking that the relationships here mean human relationships. And that was a mistake that I did not realize when I wrote the title. So, yeah, someone brought up later. So, today we are going to talk about, so this is this mandatory disclaimer from my company. So, today we are going to talk about relationship extraction, which is a key part of information extraction required to move from software that can read text to software that can understand text. Now, in this talk, we are going to talk about relationship extraction, why relationship extraction is important. Deep learning and relationship extraction, in my opinion, are a match made in heaven, and we are going to see that in this talk, that how deep learning facilitates and simplifies the task of relationship extraction. In the end, if time permits, we'll talk about how to build a knowledge graph using the knowledge using the concepts that we have seen in the prior slides, and finally the conclusion. So, in very simple words, information extraction is the application of human knowledge and machine learning to convert human text into a form that can be easily consumed by software agents. Here I have a simple example. So it's basically like converting from unstructured text to a structured pattern. And I think most of you would have seen this a lot in today's talk and in your day-to-day lives. So information extraction follows a very specific pipeline. If you want to do information extraction, like, you know, what you can do is that you can first identify the entities of interest in your text. This problem is called named entity recognition. Then what you can do is that once you have identified the entities in the text, you identify the relationship between the entities in the text. We are going to talk about both of them in the next couple of slides. Then after that, you identify which events the entities are participating in. For example, you might say that, okay, airlines is going to give a price hike, or there is going to be a rise in price of fuel. So you find the events in which the entities are participating in. And the final most difficult part, in my opinion, is the temporal expression. So Atul Singh is giving a talk today at ODSC. What does that today maps to? Mapping phrases like today, last day, yesterday, 3 days ago to exact dates in the calendar. So that is the last task that you want to do to kind of achieve information extraction. So named entity recognition is a classification problem. Given the proper nouns in the sentence, the whole idea of named entity recognition is to classify them, put them into classes. There are a lot of classes that can be used. On my right, you can see like some of the typical classes that are used: people, person, organization, location, geopolitical entity. Now, named entity recognition is becoming fairly commoditized, in my opinion. SPACI, NLTK, Stanford NLP do a good job of named entity recognition. Still, like, you know, I have written here shown here the code from SPACI to do named entity recognition, which is like just 5 lines of code, and it will show you in this very nice manner that Narendra Modi is a person, Sunday is a date, Bansagar is a location, Yogi Adityanath is a person. So this is probably, yeah. So, and still, if you have some desire to learn or for a specific need of your organization, you want to develop your own custom NER classifier, then you can use, like, you know, existing knowledge bases. Like Groning Meaning Bank is a data source which is already available with labeled data that you can use for building your NER supervised machine learning based classifier. So that's about named entity recognition, which is used to identify entities. Once you have done the named entity recognition and identifies the entities in your text, the next task that you want to do is to identify the relationship between the entities. Now, this becomes slightly complex. Now, the first task was just to take the proper nouns and classify them into classes. Now, if there are two entities in a sentence, can you take them and identify the relationship between them? Again, you can treat it as a supervised machine learning problem. Given some labeled training data, you can train a classifier and kind of decide on the classes. But the thing is this, that the nuances will vary with the domain. You know, the relationships that are important for finance will not be important for medicine. Similarly, like, you know, the things that are important for medicine might not be relevant for security purposes. So that was one of the reason I thought maybe we can talk about relationship extraction here, because this is something which is very domain specific, And it's not easy to kind of just take something out of the box and use it. What I have in top here is some examples of relationships that you could like to kind of basically a taxonomy of relationship that you might want to use to kind of identify the relations that might be of relevance to your domain or your problem space. On the bottom, there are some examples like, you know, physical location. So he was in Tennessee, part whole subsidiary, XYZ is the parent company of ABC. So these are like kind of examples of relationships. The items in blue are the examples of the entities. So remember, we said that we identified the entities, and once we have identified the entities in the sentence, we want to classify the class or the relationship in which those entities belong to. So why do we want to do information extraction and relationship extraction? So I mean, it's this typical problem that the data generation pace never ceases. We keep on generating data at ever faster pace and every day. What I have here is some example of data generation, like, you know, we have like, you know, 473K tweets generated per minute, 12 million text messages sent per minute, 2K comments per minute, and absorbing all this information and converting it into useful and actionable insights is kind of becoming a challenge that different organizations want to kind of solve. So that's where this knowledge of relationship extraction, information extraction becomes very relevant. And it's interesting because it's not that the approach of kind of doing extracting, converting from unstructured text to structured format is new. So WikiLeaks leaked about this software called Palantir, which is used by US intelligence, and they don't disclose, they are a private company, and they don't disclose how they take the unstructured information from different sources on the web and convert it into a structured format. But I thought this would be interesting because the ideas that you learn here, you could use it to build something like this, which could be extremely relevant for security. KNL is another good example of a knowledge graph, which is a project from CMU, which is like running from a large time where they try to crawl the web and try to identify different relationships on the web. Now the left side, I'm just trying to kind of highlight the importance of, like there are 4,000 listed stocks on NASDAQ. And if an investment company has to invest in these stocks, they won't have enough resources to kind of absorb the information that is being continuously generated on the internet about these stocks and take, process them and consume them. So that's just a point to highlight the importance of this. Security is very important. I mean, there's some statistics from Stats here, which says that there are like 11,000 terror attacks which happened in 2016. And if security organizations can process the information that is moving in social media and all, and can kind of point out to some, give some insights about a potential terror attack, that could lead to saving a lot of lives. So what you are learning here is extremely relevant in terms of utility. So this is, the slide here shows like how you can do relationship extraction using existing, using the older machine learning algorithms like random forest or SVM, if you want to use that for relationship extraction. So basically you take the text, you take the entities that you have identified using named entity recognition, and then you go through a feature generation phase. And then you generate a whole lot of features, like, you know, you take the entities NER type, you take the entities lemma, you kind of can concatenate the lemma and the types of the both the entities. Then you kind of generate word-based features. You take the text between the words, you take left and right of the text. Then you do syntactic features, like basically how the, what are the dependency paths, constituent paths, etc. After you have generated all of these features, then you have to kind of convert, because remember, your supervised ML will only accept numbers. So you have to pass it through a word embedding phase to convert the words into numbers, and then you pass it through the supervised ML algorithm of your choice. So you have to do all of this to kind of do relationship extraction. And with deep learning, the advantage that we get, that all of this gets converted to this. Basically, you just take the sentence and the entities, you do some pre-processing, the word embedding and the deep learning model becomes part of the model and you get the relationships. So remember, this is like again a classic supervised ML problem. But instead of doing all this feature generation that we had to do earlier, we can just let the deep learning network do this feature generation. So what is, yeah. Oh, so you have to identify the classes. So I will come back to it. Yeah, it's a short talk, so probably I'll just come back to it. Yeah. There is a slide about it after that. Okay, thanks for pointing it out. So we'll come back to that point. So what he has asked is that if you are saying it's a relationship problem, it's a supervised ML problem, that what are the relationships? So I have a whole pipeline of how you would do it. It essentially involves identifying the relationships of interest to you and then generating data for those relationships and then building the classifier we'll talk about. So typically with basically gradient ascent, gradient descent, and kind of backpropagation, we can train very large size neural networks. Now, recurrent neural networks are a special type of neural networks where the information is passed across the neurons within a layer, unlike the normal neural networks. There are multiple types of recurrent neural networks. GRU, LSTM kind of are some prominent examples of recurrent neural networks in the literature. It's difficult to say that which one is better for your problem. Better, it's like, you know, something that you will have to experiment with and see the results for yourself. So we are using like LSTM in our work. And the recurrent neural networks are very good for text processing problem because they maintain the structural information. So what they can do is that if I have a sentence, teddy bear, I'm going to present teddy bear. So the resolution of bear depends on like resolution of teddy depends on bear. There could be another sentence that Teddy Roosevelt was the first president of US. So again, the resolution of teddy there depends on the presence of Roosevelt next to it. So what recurrent neural networks do is that they can kind of, they can maintain the information in which they have seen the words in the sequence, which is not possible in normal neural networks. And that makes them very good for text processing problems. I think you have seen almost everyone is trying to use them for. So this is like an elaborate topology of the deep learning model. So we basically take the sentences, replace the entities in the sentences with the markers. Then we, what we do is that we pass it through an input layer. Then we take it through an embedding layer. What the embedding layer does is that it transforms the words into a vector space representation. Then we pass this vector space representation into a bidirectional LSTM, and after that into a dense layer with a softmax activation function. We've used cross entropy as the loss function, and what you see is the, in the end is the different relationship classes. So this is basically like the workflow that you were asking for, that let's say if your manager comes in and says that I want a relationship extraction, then what you need to do is basically you want to identify the relationships that are of interest to the problem at hand. You cannot generally say that like using a supervised approach, you cannot say that I will identify any relationship that comes to anyone's mind. You have to build some with respect, you have to build with respect to certain particular relationships. Then you have to generate label data. So for label data, one trick that's used very often in this problem space is called distant supervision. So what you say is that if you say Bill Gates and Microsoft, and this is not the cleanest technique, but it works well. So what you say that if I want label data about founder, so what I will say is that I can go and crawl the web and find different instances of sentences with Bill Gates and Microsoft together and say that in this sentence, Bill Gates and Microsoft represent the founder relationship. So that's the different distant supervision problem. So basically we crawl a corpus of text like web to find sentences that contain both the entities together, and we label them saying that the relationship for which the, we know the relationship between these two entities. So we label those sentences as saying that this is the relationship that these sentences present. Then you train the data on the model on the data, and then you evaluate the model basically. So that answers your question. So as I mentioned that we can use distant supervision, which is like, you know, if you know, if you, let's say I'm interested in five relationships, let's say founder, headquarter. So for founder, let me generate 10 tuples where I know they, these two entities are related by the relationship founder. For example, Elon Musk and Tesla, Bill Gates and Microsoft and so on and so forth. Similarly, let's say headquarters. So, you know, Facebook is headquartered in California, or like, you know, Elon Musk company is headquartered in San Mateo. So I kind of know these tuples, entity one, entity two tuples, which are related together by the relationship founder. So I take these tuples. So you had, say, five relationship, you took 10 tuples for each relationship. Then you found sentences on the web, say, for example, or you can go to a corpus of text which is very specific to your domain, and then find sentences which contain these two entities together. And you put the label saying that these two, in this sentence, these two entities are related by the relationship that I am already aware of. Yeah. Okay. Good. That answers your question? Yes, yes, for the trip. So testing, you already will like have to kind of maybe go and manually label the data and see if you want to kind of evaluate the, yes, yes, you, yeah. You have to kind of go and manually kind of find sentences and label it and do a bit of, but you can simplify this using the distant supervision technique, where you say that if those, these two entities are related, if Microsoft and Bill Gates are related by the relationship founder, then every sentence that contains Microsoft and Bill Gates as the relationship founder. So, yeah. So, what we will do is we'll quickly have a quick, okay. Yeah, go ahead. You can ask the questions. We can skip it. Yes, so that's what I was wanted to come to. Good question. So, so there are two, what you can do if you want to play with these ideas like in your personal time or whatever. So what you can do, there are two data sets available. One is the Wikilinks data set. So what Wikilinks data set does is that Google at some point, Wikilinks, yeah. So what Wikilinks data set does is that Google at some point kind of anointed different entities with the URL, with their corresponding URL in Wikipedia, so that it becomes easy to kind of disambiguate names within sentences, etc. I don't remember the full context of it right now, but certain university, I think UMass, has, what they have done is that they not merely, they have extended the Wikilinks by taking corresponding sentences for these entities from Wikipedia. So what you can do is that something like this, entity one, entity two, the sentence on the left, middle, right. So you get the whole sentence with two entities in them. Next thing what you want to do is that you want to classify or label these sentences. How do you do that? There is kind of something called Freebase. So Freebase was another collaborative effort where people had manually labeled relationships between entities. It is no longer like, you know, active, but you can still get data dump of Freebase. So once you take the Freebase data dump, you will get relationships between known entities. You can merge these two together to kind of label your data. Once you have labeled the data, what you can do is you just like need to do a little bit of pre-processing and all, and then eventually you can do the train test split, and then you can build the model, which is basically what the same thing I said. You kind of, this is in Keras in Python, you add an embedding layer, you add a bidirectional LSTM, and then kind of you add a dense layer, and then you train and test the model. So that's about information extraction part of it. Yes. Yes, Stanford library is what Stanford has an entity information extraction parser that does a good job of relationship extraction. But the thing what it does is that it takes the two entities and tries to kind of give a very simple, it uses some kind of, like I think a clustering kind of approach, where it kind of tries to simplify the text from the information in the text, it tries to give the relationship. OpenAI is another one, I think, which can do this to some extent. But then the next step where, like, you know, these texts will be like very random. So again, you will have to take these texts and pass it through a classifier to give some fixed labels. Okay, so that's kind of covers. So let me come to the conclusion. Yeah. So we have kind of demonstrated how you can do extracting entities and relationships. I'm sorry, we are not able to cover the knowledge graph. So key limitations, there are like at least two key limitations that you should keep in mind. We have not talked about coreference resolution, which is finding all expressions. So for example, removing he or she to kind of the nouns that it is referring to, and duplicate resolution while populating knowledge graphs. So that's probably not relevant because we have not talked about it. Thank you.